This is Portage Avenue. It runs from the corner of Portage and Main through Winnipeg's Central Business District and out west past city limits. Once known as the Portage Trail, it extends west almost 800 miles to Edmonton. It's a wide street originally laid out at 132 feet, four lanes of traffic each way. Portage Avenue contains a mix of elegant architecture from its golden era and an eclectic collection of newer structures that speak of today.
Funding for this program has been provided by the Winnipeg Foundation and by the members of Prairie Public.
The year is 1905. Winnipeg is entering a fabulous new era of growth, and it's all happening along Portage Avenue. Its warehouse district around Old City Hall is already well built. Banks and shops from the 1880s and 1890s line Main Street for miles. But a new light is shining on Portage Avenue, and the path is being blazed by the new Eaton store. At five stories and occupying an entire city block, Eaton's will start a flurry of new construction that in 10 years will transform Portage Avenue and truly make it Winnipeg's Main Street.
Eaton started in Winnipeg in 1905. It was a huge building and it employed many, many people. It employed generation after generation and in some cases families of people. And everybody you run into when you say you've worked at Eaton's, they say either I know somebody or I've worked there too. I actually met my husband while working at Eaton's 27 years ago.
Eaton's lead is followed by two more important players. The new Winnipeg Post Office and the Bank of Nova Scotia both leave behind Main Street's Bankers Row to take up prominent places on Portage Avenue. And at the corner of Portage and Main, railway developer John Duncan MacArthur will build Winnipeg's first skyscraper, the MacArthur Building, better known as the Child's Building. Portage Avenue fast becomes Winnipeg's new avenue of dreams. Portage Avenue bubbled with life, filled with shops, theaters, and restaurants. Fueled by the draw of two major department stores, Eaton's and the Bay. 50 other stores found success located between these two retail giants.
The Winnipeg downtown store was 865,000 square feet. So it offered everything that anybody could want. It was like a full-line mall housed in one big store.
I can remember working at Eaton's before World War II. Eaton's was a very, very busy place at that time. I think they accounted for two-thirds of the retail sales in the city of Winnipeg. And they would put on special sales. One they had was their Trans-Canada sale. And at 9 o'clock when that gong went off, people literally stampeded into the store. They ran up the stairs with a pounding of feet and up the elevators. And it was quite a sight to see them come pouring into the store.
Every day we experience something interesting. Women whipping off their blouses in the middle of the department, trying on other blouses.
There were 42 windows in the building. We tried to make the goods look exciting and different. The displays that we did in the store and the type of window designs that we did had to be very sophisticated, interesting, exciting, different, eye-catching.
As a teenager, coming down to Portage Avenue into the Bay or Eaton's downtown was the place to be, to meet a whole bunch of people from all over the city. It was a central hub and there was a lot of excitement. It was a hustle and bustle and running into people and just an activity level that was second to none in Winnipeg.
Street of the avenue was quite different in the early days. People worked downtown. There were a lot of office buildings, the Childs buildings. There were so many small stores on Portage Avenue at that time, specialty stores, shoe stores, jewelry stores, theaters, several theaters that have disappeared since then. It was alive. I can remember going into the Capitol Theater. You had to go in from the Portage entrance, and there was a long ramp, red carpeting, and all around you was gold, gilt, very plush. It made you feel pretty nice to go in there. The Capitol Theater is where I saw Gone with the Wind. Of course, the Capitol Theater is gone.
I think there were greater days when Portage literally was the center of commerce, and there were restaurants up and down the street.
One of the memories I had was going to the Child's restaurant. The building it was in, it was on the ground floor, became known as the Child's Building.
It was the major restaurant in Winnipeg. You could spend a week in Child's restaurant and see everybody in business in Winnipeg.
There was the old Mardi Gras restaurant that supposedly was the first gay restaurant in Winnipeg. Moore's restaurant was where I remember taking my first date.
That parade, it was the popular pastime. That's before there were girls and watched the parade go by. I'm talking about the girls. That parade, it was the popular pastime. That's before there were any.
At the western end of the business district sits the Bay Retail Store.
The Bay is the world's longest continuous operating company, and it was incorporated on May 2nd, 1670 as the Company of Adventurers Trading into Hudson's Bay. This particular store was opened in November of 1926. The store opened at 9 a.m. by one of the directors of the company, Mr. Galt, opened the door with a golden key. And during the day, the store was visited by 50,000 customers. The Bay viewed Portage Avenue as very important because it was like a portal to downtown Winnipeg. Looking at the exterior, you're struck by the architectural highlights, the tindal stone. The very fact that this building was built with an attention to detail, the people that had this building built wanted it to be a signature building. It was built to be 10 stories high. It stopped at 6 stories. This building is 675,000 square feet, incorporating 7 retail floors, including the basement. The building offers something for everybody, starting with the basement, our newly expanded food market, to just a gorgeous cosmetic department on the main floor. The second floor is home to our men's assortment. The third floor, of course, is anchored by the mirror room, full of fashion. Move to the fourth floor, where we have housewares, linens, china. Also on the sixth floor is the very historical Paddle Wheel restaurant. And I'm sure that just anyone familiar with Winnipeg has been in the Paddle Wheel at some time, where there's the actual Paddle Wheel ship with the wheel that turns and the different murals of prairie life. The Paddle Wheel restaurant's got a lot of memories in it, especially fond memories are in the 60s when it was a meeting place for teenagers. The music scene was there. It's rumored that Burton Cummings used to visit the Paddle Wheel quite often. Something very interesting that happened once during one of our Bay Day sales, and we were always famous for the clock specials we had. And in the food market, they had a clock special, limited time, limited quantity sale on frozen turkeys. Well, it turned out that they were down to the last turkey, and two women both had their hands on it and were fighting over a frozen turkey. One woman took the turkey, hit the other woman over the head with the turkey, and knocked her unconscious. She's the one that kept the turkey.
Castles in the sky are certainly what Portage Avenue's first builders had in mind, and there is no better example than William Boyd's landmark building.
One of my favorite buildings along Portage Avenue is the Boyd Building. Boyd made his money on confectionery. In 1912, he was bought up by a national company. He used that capital then to build the Boyd Building. Mr. Boyd decided that Portage Avenue was the place to be, and in fact, he was right. By that time, Portage Avenue was really developing as sort of the main thoroughfare of Winnipeg. He contracted J.D. Acheson, who was one of Winnipeg's most famous architects, who had been trained in Chicago. The Boyd Building, in its design and in its construction, was a very important statement. Of course, Winnipeg was trying to do everything that Chicago was doing. They were trying to mimic Chicago's development and its success. The economy was booming just prior to World War I. There was a lot of capital. It was really a sort of a golden age for construction in Winnipeg, and certainly Portage Avenue. When you walk down the street, even today, it's one of the most magnificent Portage Avenue buildings. The difference in color, the white of the cream terracotta versus the dark green of the interior terracotta, it's just a spectacular building.
I consider Portage Avenue to be my neighborhood. In fact, I walk to and from work on Portage Avenue every day, regardless of the season and regardless of the weather. To walk down Portage Avenue can actually be exalting, and it's often the highlight of my day. When I walk down Portage Avenue, I see some of the grand buildings that were built at the turn of the 20th century, and I can visualize what Winnipeg would have been like at that time, when it was an up-and-coming city of the future and one of the largest and fastest-growing cities in North America. My favorite building on Portage Avenue is the Bank of Nova Scotia. The Bank of Nova Scotia is really a landmark on Portage Avenue. It's the only domed building, for example, on the street. The role of ornamentation in the early 20th century was really to draw the public's attention to the building. It's a beautiful example of terracotta in Winnipeg. The building is dotted with shields that are the corporate seal of the Bank of Nova Scotia. And you can see a schooner, and beneath that, a fish and a plow. And this ornamentation is saying, this is the Bank of Nova Scotia. This is our corporate image. You have arrived on Portage Avenue. I can't believe that as recently as the early 1980s, someone really thought that this is a building to be demolished. The Bank of Nova Scotia has really had a new life. It's now a government-owned building and a public space. It's a vital statistics office where people now can go into the banking hall and actually marvel at the beautiful interior. For example, the coffered ceiling and the gold leaf and beautiful brass fittings. The Paris building across the road from the Bank of Nova Scotia is another example of terracotta in Winnipeg. It's a very prominent building because of its height, but it's really the ornamentation that draws your eye. This is terracotta that mimics cut stone. There's a band of angels on the fifth floor of the Paris building, and this used to be the top of the building. And to even prove it, you can see the cornice line right above. There are a number of angels on the Paris building, including right underneath the vaulted cornice at the very top. My favorite feature of ornamentation on the Paris building is not an angel at all. It's the bare-breasted women that you see on the second floor. The Curry building was built in 1915. In fact, it was built in the summer of 1915, the same time that the first phase of the Paris building was being built, despite the fact that this was World War I. The Curry building takes its name from the family who founded it, the Curry family. It's a commercial building, it always has been, and it's still a viable building, even though it's only two stories high. When you look at the Curry building, you can really feel the thrust of the horizontal. The Curry building is made of an exquisite type of terracotta that's made to look like granite. So it's got a dappled buff color with splotches of gray and black. It's got a Gothic motif. For example, you'll see tracery, the lacy look, very much like a Gothic cathedral. And every second pair of columns, where they have little leafy tops, have poking from them a little face. It's a scribe with a tri-cornered hat. The Curry building was to be extended another six stories in 1928, and the decision was made to delay a year, and then of course the Great Depression intervened. So what we see today is still a two-story Curry building.
Another of the really amazing buildings on Portage Avenue is the former Burke's building. It was originally built in 1900-1901 as Winnipeg's first YMCA. It had a massive, strong, textured limestone facade on two sides. It had a lot of ornamentation, a lot of Romanesque ornamentation. Looked a lot different than it does today. When the YMCA left in 1912, of course, they had to find a buyer for their former building, and they found a perfect match in the Burke's Jewelry Company. Henry Burke had started in Montreal. Burke really wanted to be on Portage Avenue, just like everybody else, but he didn't want it to look like the YMCA building. He hired Percy Knobbs from Montreal to create a beautiful frieze along the front and the side of the building. It's a magnificent mixture of terracotta and mosaic tile. The frieze tells a number of stories, actually. Lower on the frieze are medallions of terracotta, and they depict the materials used by jewelers. There's an elephant for ivory, there's a man diving for pearls, there's miners. So that kind of tells the story of the jewelry trade. It's a magnificent piece of art. Unfortunately, right now, it's one of the vacant buildings on Portage Avenue.
While parts of Portage Avenue's past have been lost, they have been relatively few. One old building that succumbed is the Time Building.
The day that the Time Building burnt down, I can remember it quite vividly because we lived next door to a family called Redmonds, and they owned J.G.H. McLean, and they occupied the ground floor of the Time Building. About 6 o'clock in the morning, their son called to me and banged on the door and said, "Come on, we're going down to watch a fire." And it was raining and it was blowing. It was a really hard wind blowing the rain. This is what caused the fire. The moisture, the force of the wind forced the moisture up into their sign, the J.G.H. McLean sign, and it caught on fire inside of the building. They tried to put the fire out and were unable to do so. Eaton's had its own firefighting system, had its own wells, and they were able to put a curtain of water down the front of the building and on the building, on the side of the building on Hargrave Street and protect their own building. If they hadn't done that, they say that the heat of that alone would have just, Eaton's would have caught on fire that day. Quite something to see that building going up in flame in the middle of a rainstorm. You couldn't put it out.
At the east end of Portage Avenue is Canada's best-known intersection, the intersection of Portage and Main, the center of Winnipeg's financial district. It's the pulse of the city. It's where every head office wants to be. It's a corner steeped in history and controversy. It was so congested with traffic, especially pedestrian traffic, that 30 years ago, they banned pedestrian crossings, forcing people underground. Whenever Winnipeg has something to celebrate, it happens at Portage and Main. Peace Day in 1919, the signing of Bobby Hull to the Jets, or the Blue Bombers' win of the Grey Cup. The party happens at Portage and Main.
After World War II, going down Portage Avenue was a spectacular, joyous event. Queens and Kings visit to Winnipeg in 1939. Portage Avenue was the lifeblood of the city of Winnipeg.
Of all the buildings that have been lost on Portage Avenue, the most wrenching loss has been that of the Eaton store. The store that had done $100 million in business annually was bankrupt.
So the last day when the store was open and the cameras were all there and the last general manager was getting ready to shut the door and say goodbye to everyone, and the sales had gone on for many months, we knew that we were putting another nail in the coffin of downtown.
It was a surprise, bigger than anything I could have imagined, and it was clearly one of the saddest days of my life.
when people found out that Eaton's was going to be demolished, there were a number of people that were really angry. I think they wanted to retain the old Eaton's as they remembered it, almost at any cost.
People were really emotional. Either they were in one camp or the other. Eaton's is a landmark issue in that it really said, do we move forward or do we allow Portage Avenue to kind of sit there and wait for something to happen? And I think in Winnipeg, the politicians said, we can't afford to just sit and wait. We have to do something now.
While it happened gradually, by the mid-1980s, the decline of Portage Avenue alarmed civic officials, confronting the same story as in most North American cities. Suburban malls had eaten away the business of the downtown stores. To offset the decline, a new downtown shopping mall named Portage Place was built through a public-private partnership.
Portage Place is a four-level shopping center. It was built in 1987 by Cadillac Fairview in conjunction with the three levels of government. It has over 125 retail stores and offices and houses the only IMAX theater, Arts Theater The Globe, and Prairie Theater Exchange in Winnipeg.
Did Portage Place cause the death of Eaton's?
Portage Place did not kill Eaton's whatsoever. Eaton's, as you know, struggled a long time when it was passed down in the families, and I believe it could have kept going had someone in their family run it a lot better. Portage Place actually was a great supporter of Eaton's.
Anchoring the west end of the Portage Place redevelopment is the Investors Tower.
I joined Investors in 1976. At the time that we were considering the redevelopment of a head office, the problem of Portage Avenue and the redevelopment of Portage Avenue, as someone had said, North Portage Avenue reminded them of downtown Beirut. There were so many empty buildings and derelict buildings. Maybe the best contribution that Investors could make was that we would anchor the west end of the commercial aspect of Portage Avenue by developing our head office here on Portage Avenue. My feeling was that if there was one symbol for Western Canada, it was the grain elevator. The roof line and everything is intended to be symbolic of what I think Kipling once referred to, the castles of commerce, the grain elevator. The colors were intended to be earth, brown and green, again, seeking that aspect there at the attachment to the land. The windows and the glass as being the reflective of the big sky country of air and light. And maybe it was my vision that resulted in the sculpture. That's what has been captured there. It is a Prairie Boy's vision of what we have done and what we can do. He's looking out, and he's looking up and looking to the future.
140 years earlier, another man had looked at the emergent prairie landscape and saw Portage Avenue's future. Henry McKenney, establishing the first business at Portage and Main. McKenney arrived in 1859 on the Anson Northup, the first steamboat to reach the Red River Colony from Georgetown, Minnesota. McKenney bought a storehouse from Andrew McDermott and in 1862 converted it into the first hotel called the Royal. The die was cast. Buildings sprang up in a few short years. The corner was booming. Once the corners were built up by the end of World War I, the corner stayed pretty much the same through World War II, through the 50s and 60s. No new buildings. The famous corner of Portage and Main had seen no sense of modern times. But it was not for lack of trying. George Richardson heads up Winnipeg's Richardson family. His grandfather started life as a tailor in Kingston, Ontario, but discovered a more profitable business.
Very soon he found it was more fun to trade in grain than to make clothes. In the early days, Portage and Main was thought to be the crossroads in Western Canada. It just became obvious that if you're going to be in the grain trade, and that's what we were at that time, this was the place to be. In the 20s, my father was very desirous of developing a building on the corner of Portage and Main, and obtained the property, had the building designed, and actually started the excavation. They were well down in the excavation when the crash came. My father thought that was not the time to build a building. So he canceled, paid off the contractor, filled in the hole, and we turned the corner into a parking lot. It was never, if it was a building was going to be built, it was simply a matter of when.
Finally, in 1964, Winnipeg's first true skyscraper started to rise.
The building is just over 400 feet above ground. It is over 600,000 square feet. The exterior of the building is precast Manitoba granite. The fondest memory of the building, probably the completion, the topping off of the building. We'd finally made it. We're still in Winnipeg because if you're going to be in the grain trade, it's the only place to be. There's a big advantage to Winnipeg. It has all the amenities of life. It's the center of North America and the only place really to be.
The next tower to rise at Portage and Main was the Trizec Tower, built in 1979 at the southwest corner.
The Commodity Exchange Tower is part of the Winnipeg Square development at Portage and Main. The development is comprised of the tower, the shops of Winnipeg Square, Winnipeg Square parking garage, and the Bank of Nova Scotia. The tower itself is 535,000 square feet, 31 stories, anodized aluminum and glass. We have quite a variety of tenants. We have certainly law firms, national accounting firms, stockbrokers. We have, of course, the Winnipeg Commodity Exchange. When people come into work for the day, they can park underground, get to their office, do their shopping, go for lunch, and stay inside. The merchants in the shops of Winnipeg Square, by and large, are doing very, very well. The reason these shops do well is because of traffic. Those numbers total over 100,000 people a week.
The Trizec building had been a controversial project.
It was a very grand scheme which captured the imagination of the city council. They were driven by this view that if they built the corner big, it would maintain it as the third most important city in the country. They decided to plunk into the middle of that famous corner the largest complex that Winnipeg had ever seen. When you have an important corner, you have a historically interesting corner, is this the best we could have done? And my answer is this is not the best that we could have done. We could have designed it differently and had a better city for it.
The Bank of Montreal. Bank of Montreal is the Bank of Montreal. And it doesn't do that. The Grand Dam is the Bank of Montreal. Montreal. The Bank of Montreal.
Indeed, the Bank of Montreal stands like a Roman temple at the southeast corner, its marble facade glistening in the afternoon light, at night gleaming like a timeless beacon at the crossroads of the city.
The branch was designed by McKim, Mead and White. Exterior is granite. We have six columns on the exterior. Such a special experience when you come in the main doors. It's just overwhelming. You walk into our main banking hall, and we are the oldest banking hall still operating in Canada. You walk in that hall and you look up at the ceilings and you look around at the walls, and it's so expansive and so beautiful. The ceiling is gold leaf, very intricately designed ceiling. In 1980, we did have it estimated,
and it was estimated at $1 million. At the back of our buildings, stained glass windows, you will see that they bear three coat of arms. They have the banks, they have the provinces, and they have our countries. And it's so difficult for me to put into words how it feels to be working at Winnipeg, Maine, Bank of Montreal. The premise outside in the evening, particularly in the later evening when it's dusk and the lights are on, it makes your heart swell. And to be able to say to anyone, family, friends, that I work at Bank of Montreal, Portage and Main is such a privilege.
The most recent corner to see change is the new Toronto Dominion Bank Tower at the northwest corner. It's just changed hands, coming into local ownership by the Asper family.
Our family is extremely rooted in the city of Winnipeg. When this building came up for sale, we figured that it's a great investment, but it's also really a symbol for us. You know, as far as we're concerned, the best office building in town. It's a 33-story building with a beautiful rounded or semicircular glass facade that goes all the way up the building. You know, one of the great things about it is the plaza that was built out in front, and there's a skylight that brings natural light into the concourse. Well, there's this huge open entranceway, you know, it's two or three stories high and all glass, and so you can see it, and it feels warm.
What do I think about the closure of Portage and Main? I hate it.
The closure of Portage and Main to pedestrians has raged in controversy for 25 years.
Without pedestrians crossing Portage and Main, it lost something. A number of people said that when they put those barriers up, you took away the heart of Winnipeg.
In cities that feel vibrant, you see the people on the street. When you take them off the street, it looks empty.
I personally feel that Portage and Main should be open. It's perhaps the great intersection in Canada.
There's no question about it. It is the one icon of Winnipeg that is known probably more than any other place or location.
There are certain points at which traffic flow of vehicles ought not to be the determining factor of the character of a place. Where there's a will, there's a way.
When they put the barricades up at Portage and Main, it was part of an urban planning trend to try to move traffic in and out of the center of the city faster. What I think experience has shown in the re-energization of downtowns is actually congestion works better. It makes people feel safer. And downtowns aren't a freeway. My view would be that we should reopen the intersection to pedestrian traffic and bring people back above ground.
With the opening of the concourse, we needed to be where the traffic was. Our customers said to us, we don't like it down here. We don't like to bank underground. We want to go upstairs. So we then made a decision as a company to listen to our customers, and we moved back upstairs.
Plans are underway to reopen the corner to pedestrians and to find ways to celebrate the corner. Only one building owner is opposed. The challenges for Portage Avenue grow each year. A search is on for the way Portage Avenue used to be. Lively, crowded, the place you want it to be, things you wanted to see, the hot spot. But is it possible to turn back time to the way Portage used to be?
You've got to give people a reason to be in your downtown beyond retail. You've got to bring them for festivals, events. You've got to give them an opportunity to do things in the downtown they can't do anywhere else in the city. And as such, when you have them down here, then as a retailer, you have an opportunity to get them through your door.
In the final analysis, we also have to develop a hinterland to Portage Avenue where people live.
We need much more residential development, not just social housing, which we have some of, but middle-class people with money that they want to spend. The downtown is going to be successful as a retail operation, it has to distinguish itself, and there has to be destination shopping for a particular kind of product.
Manitoba Hydro will build a major new office on Portage Avenue. This signature office tower will house 2,000 new employees and is expected to improve the future of downtown Winnipeg. Winnipeg's growing Aboriginal population is more and more present along Portage Avenue. Center Plan addresses this issue.
We have to integrate Aboriginal people into society. And I'd like to see more history and more presence of Aboriginal culture throughout the downtown. And I think it would serve as a point of pride to a people that we've really let go.
I think the Aboriginals will ultimately be one of the great contributors of the new vitality of Central Winnipeg.
Some are placing optimism in the new arena project being built on the old Eaton site, planned to open in 2004.
The True North project that was announced will be a downtown arena and entertainment center, which will not save downtown nor be the panacea of downtown redevelopment, but will certainly bring a large number of entertainment users to the downtown area, which we have been fighting for a long time.
The construction of the new arena on Portage Avenue could be a huge catalyst, but the experience across North America has been mixed as to whether those projects actually do enliven downtown. Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. If our city and provincial governments remain committed to creating a village downtown, to densify and to congest, then I could see a great renaissance for Portage Avenue. But it takes a really steadfast commitment to rebuild the downtown. If you had the magic wand and the resources to do it, what would you do with Portage Avenue is, I think, quite simply, I would turn it into an entertainment strip. And I would see a lot of restaurants, probably at the expense of a traffic lane on either side, so that you could create setbacks, proper setbacks of the buildings and patios out front, and create a Champs-Élysées type of stroll. As they're constructing the new arena, they've closed two lanes of traffic. And, you know, it's funny, but we're surviving.
One of Winnipeg's success stories is truly Cordon Avenue, an old world flavor created by the Italian business community, alive with people long into summer nights. Can this be the future of Portage Avenue?
Cordon Avenue has become a stroll, and it's dotted with all kinds of great restaurants and patios and Cinzano umbrellas and people laughing and having a good time, and there's a lot of traffic. It moves very slowly. There's a lot of people watching. The sidewalks are crowded. Why not do it on Portage Avenue? Why not? You have to plan it. You have to design it, and you have to have the guts to say, I'm getting outside the box here. Come along with me and smile, and let's enjoy the street again. Let's make Portage Cordon.
Through its long life, Portage Avenue has been the lifeblood of the city. The challenge in its second century is not to try to recapture its long-gone past, but to try to re-energize its soul, put people and attractions back on the street, tell its stories, interpret its rich architecture, and to once again proudly celebrate Portage and Main.
To order a VHS copy of Portage Avenue Dreams of Castles in the Sky or a DVD version of Portage Avenue Dreams of Castles in the Sky that also includes Assiniboine Park, a park for all seasons, call 1-800-359-6900 or visit Prairie Public's website at www.prairiepublic.org.